So let's start the disruption report with Tesla and an overview of the current state of Tesla and the future outlook. And let's also take a look at that insane stock. I mean, won't that thing ever stop rising? I mean, just look at that, it doesn't want to stop.
Then in other news, Byton has basically been saved by Foxconn. We have two very cool screen announcements, one from Cadillac with the Lyriq and the other one from Mercedes for their upcoming EQS. And NIO has revealed the ET7 with a solid-state battery and huge range. Then we'd like to talk about our good old eVTOLs again. And Urban Aeronautics has a first customer for their really fascinating CityHawk. And lastly, a new Hyperloop test track is planned for Groningen in the Netherlands. A lot to talk about as always, so stay tuned.
So Tesla is just rising and rising, and then you think it will make a small pause or a correction or something, but then it just rises even more, and then you think it's so exaggerated already it has to correct at some point, but then it just rises even more. So last year, Tesla managed to sell 500,000 cars, and this despite a global pandemic and economic troubles of epic proportions. Almost all other car makers were declining, except for maybe a few Chinese electric car makers such as NIO. But Tesla was just completely ignoring all economic troubles and sold 36% more cars in 2020 than in 2019. They just continue their exponential growth, which they have been showing since when they started 12 years ago with the Tesla Roadster. And with all the factories coming online in 2021, it is pretty clear that this number will rise even more this year and in the coming years. We think that Tesla might very probably sell around 800,000 cars this year. With any luck, they might even get very close to the 1 million number. The secret here will be Gigafactory Shanghai, which has now already started Model Y production and is estimated to build over 400,000, possibly even 500,000 Model 3s and Model Ys in Shanghai. Then Giga Berlin will start producing Model Ys in summer this year. And by fall this year, Giga Texas should also go online. So a sales number of 1 million cars this year is not so unrealistic. And Tesla being an exponentially growing company, they are already contemplating where to build the next Gigafactories. The final sales number Tesla is aiming for is 20 million cars per year by 2030, which is about what all legacy car makers are producing annually nowadays combined. And this, of course, in combination with excessive money printing and a brutally rising inflation, is leading to a gigantic rally of the Tesla stock. Now, you know us, we are Tesla bulls, but we have to say that this is starting to look really a bit unhealthy. Such an insane growth normally always leads to a pretty brutal correction.
And we want to say the usual disclaimer here. We are not financial advisors, and this is only our opinion. And please do your own research before investing. But even though we think that Tesla will have earned such a valuation, we would have guessed that this is still 5 years away. Currently, the Tesla stock is overhyped, and we expect a correction of at least 50%. Repeat, at least 50% at some point this year. If you look at the market cap, Tesla is currently worth more than all other car makers on the planet combined. Like, combined. And electric car startups are especially overhyped right now, such as NIO or XPeng, for example, who also have very high valuations for the quite small amount of cars they produce. So even though we all know that EVs are indeed the future, we should be very careful right now when investing in such companies. Just our opinion. We certainly wouldn't buy Tesla stock right now, and we are going to wait until a big correction comes until we buy. Anyways, this is just our opinion. So if Tesla continues to pump to $10,000 or something like that by next week, please, please don't be angry with us. And please subscribe to our channel, because we don't only report on spaceflight and space exploration technology news, but also on the latest development regarding all disruptive technologies, such as electric cars, air taxis, and Hyperloop. Thank you so much in advance.
In other news, do you remember Byton? We used to talk about them a few times because their M-Byte SUV had this really enormous interior screen spanning from side to side, but they basically almost died when the pandemic started last year. But now it seems that Foxconn has saved them with a $200 million investment and partnership, and that Byton will now be a key part in Foxconn's EV strategy. Cool, so we hope we're still going to see the Byton M-Byte in production one day, because that car still has potential. Even though, of course, because they are much later to the market than they had initially planned, they will now face a lot more competition than they would have 2 years ago.
Because they won't be the only ones anymore with a gigantic screen. That trend is quickly spilling over to other car makers. And for example, Cadillac just unveiled the interior ultrawide 33-inch screen, which they will use in their Lyriq SUV. Looks pretty neat, we have to say. The Lyriq also has a hood with multiple layers of depth, and even screens in the back, so that the kids can watch the latest Avengers. But Mercedes, of course, doesn't want to be left behind, so they announced the MBUX Hyperscreen for their upcoming EQS Sedan. It's a ginormous 43-inch screen spanning the entire interior from side to side. Compared to the screen of the Byton M-Byte though, the Hyperscreen consists of three separate screens under a common curved Gorilla Glass surface. This is certainly very impressive for a car maker that was until not too long ago known for being really quite conservative design-wise. And again, we have to thank Tesla for this, because they were the first one to use fully digital screens already back in 2012, way before any other car maker was even thinking of this.
And now they all want to outdo each other. Funny, isn't it? We, by the way, predict the same when the Cybertruck comes out and the other car makers start realizing that people actually like unconventional and futuristic designs. That will probably also spark a massive race where the car makers will try to outdo each other with more and more futuristic designs. Anyways, back on topic, in other news, we had another cool reveal with NIO showing us their upcoming ET7 Sedan.
So, what is so special about this car? It looks nice and all, but what's really cool about this car is that it will be supposedly featured a solid-state battery with up to 150 kWh of capacity. This will allow for a range of 1,000 km or 622 miles, which is of course freaking amazing. NIO says that the car will already come out next year. We are very curious, especially about the solid-state battery, which will be supplied by CATL. While solid-state batteries will offer higher energy densities of over 350 watt-hours per kilogram and faster charging times in the realm of minutes, they currently still degrade too fast, and we are curious to find out how CATL will have managed to overcome these problems. We hope this is real and not just some marketing talk, because solid-state batteries, if the degradation problem is overcome, can become a real game changer for electric cars. And having NIO announce the ET7 with that technology for a release next year is extremely exciting.
On the topic of life extension, we'd like to briefly mention a nice Q&A that the Futurist Foundation did with leading anti-aging expert Aubrey de Grey. We put the link into the description. The Futurist Foundation is a non-profit organization with the purpose to promote crowdsourced projects seeking to educate the public on the matters of futurism and to support research into legal and ethical questions concerning future technology and its usage. The video is really an excellent watch for anyone interested in the topic of life extension. Regarding air taxis, or eVTOLs, which stands for Electric Vertical Takeoff and Landing, a term which we're going to use more often from now on, we have had already mentioned Urban Aeronautics' CityHawk VTOL a few times on this channel. It is an Israeli company and they have been working on the CityHawk since quite a while now. If something deserves the name flying car, then this here, because it really looks similar to a car in shape, since it has no wings or openly visible rotors of any kind. Now the two rotors are hidden on the interior of the aircraft, which allows it a maximum speed of 270 kph and a range of up to 150 km with four persons on board. But it can actually take up to 6 persons. We assume the range will be more towards 100 kilometers then, but still impressive. And now they have the first customer, namely Hatzolah Air. Hatzolah Air's mission is to provide, arrange, facilitate and fund local, national and worldwide air transportation. Hatzolah's flights include medical, humanitarian, disaster relief, compassion, end of life and lift me up flights for the sick and infirm, as well as urgent and emergent charitable flights. And since the CityHawk is perfect for med-evac or emergency response scenarios, it is understandable that Hatzolah Air has ordered 4 of them. The CityHawk's interior is 20-30% larger than the interior of a med-evac helicopter, but much more silent with 76 dBA at 50 meters of distance. So this is definitely a very good use case for the CityHawk. And of course later, we are certain to see the CityHawk also perform the function of air taxi.
And even though some people really, really hate Hyperloop and want to intimidate us not to speak about it, on this channel here, we brutally ignore the Hyperloop haters. Such people would also have said that airplanes will never happen, or that cars will never replace horses. Anyways, a new Hyperloop test track will be built in Groningen in the Netherlands next year. The Dutch Hyperloop company, Hardt Hyperloop, that we have also mentioned a few times, plans to build a 2.6 km long test track with a 1.4 meter diameter tube. So this will be a cargo scale tube. But we know that the tube can be expanded to larger diameters as would be needed to transport humans. It will be the first facility in Europe to test this transport system at high speeds. Here, features like levitation, propulsion, stabilization, cornering, lane switching, and emergency braking will be tested. Hardt Hyperloop uses a hanging magnetic levitation principle, where the propulsion system with the electromagnets is mounted on top, the pot thus hanging. Now, while a 2.6 km test track doesn't sound impressive, we should keep in mind that Hyperloop is still very young. It took the car decades from invention in 1886 until it became more widely used, and also quite a few decades from the Wright brothers' first flight in 1903 until mainstream air travel. New technologies just need a lot more time from inception until mainstream than many people realize.
And if you're more interested in the latest spaceflight technology developments, you can watch the latest JS Space Report right here.
So thanks for watching the first JS Disruption Report in 2021. And I would say, on to the future.
The Futurist Foundation is a non-profit organization with the purpose to promote
You're more interested in the space flight technologies, you can watch the JS Space Report routine or something like that. For the Disruption Report.
So.
Because the latest Disruption Report was already last year.
Yeah, you're right.